This video is brought to you by Straight Goods News, Canada's alternative online news source. Visit straightgoods.ca.
Thank you very much. The Liberal Party called this press conference because we are deeply concerned for patient care, not only the immediate patient care, but the long-term availability of prescription drugs. This will really harm patients' health and, in some instances, their lives. The government of Canada and the Minister of Health has mismanaged this issue, as far as we've been concerned. In December 2010, the pharmacists, the Canadian Pharmacy Association, told the government that there was going to be a shortage of drugs in Canada and around the world, and that this was escalating. It was worse than it had been 5 years ago. They asked the government to look at this issue as a critical one and to take steps immediately to start to investigate and to set in place some sort of system that will avert the kind of crisis we're talking about today that we see happening in Canada, and to have a long-term plan for being able to get drugs over the long term. As Liberals, in September of 2011, we called on the Minister of Health to do the same thing, to investigate the issue and set up an immediate and long-term plan to avert the crises if they should occur and to ensure that Canadians do have drugs when they need them over the long term. Because the minister did not respond except to say that she has asked the pharmaceutical industry to look at it, we asked the health committee, and I brought a motion to the health committee in September of 2011 asking the committee to investigate and study the issue. Now, we were asking the committee to do so because the Congress of the United States Health Committee had already studied the issue, and President Obama had taken it very seriously, and he had actually asked his Department of Justice to look at the issue of why certain drugs were not being produced anymore by certain countries. Now, the Minister of Health said that she had set up a voluntary system in which the pharmaceutical industry would put on a website when drugs are in short demand. This is not good enough. Telling us that there are not going to be enough drugs does not answer the problem. You have to get the drugs to the patients who need them. Knowing they cannot get them does not help the patients with their health or with their medication. The FDA in the United States at the same time set up an 11-person team to work directly with industry to avert crises and to make sure that there were drugs available for Americans. In fact, they averted 195 instances like the one we're seeing in Canada now. We are frustrated. We're concerned because we decided that this is impacting on patient health in a very real and a very disconcerting way. So we held a round table in November last year with my colleague, Geoff Regan, and with the industry and all of the stakeholders, academics, physicians, pharmacists, to talk about what we could do. We heard from them again that it was important for the federal government to take a leadership position and to work with provinces and to work with the industry, investigate the problem, and try to avert crises before they happen. The minister continued to say that the voluntary system of telling us when there were no drugs was going to work. Well, you know, this is not good enough again, and as a physician, I find this an unacceptable thing to put people's lives and health in jeopardy. Now, we're talking here about common prescription drugs. We're not talking about extraordinary drugs. We're talking about drugs such as medications that people use for asthma. We're talking about intravenous drugs that are used in the operating room, in the intensive care unit, in emergency situations. Those things are in short supply. We're talking about painkillers used in the operating room. We're talking about pediatric antibiotics for children. We're talking about certain specific cancer drugs that if patients cannot have them, they cannot be treated for their cancer. So one we're talking about some rarefied problem here. Now that we see there is a crisis with Sandoz, which as you know is a large generic company here in Canada, slowing down production and creating a shortage of essential drugs for OR and of intensive care units and emergency departments, we now see the government suddenly scrambling around to find substitute drugs to replace that. Well, as a physician, I can tell you that this is just not good enough. First and foremost, many substitute drugs are not as effective and do not have the same impact on the patient that the drugs that many of the other drugs have. Secondly, they are expensive if you have to get big pharma drugs as opposed to generic drugs. And thirdly, This is a global issue and why we might scramble right now and find drugs from other countries, offshore drugs. This is not going to continue to happen because we're facing a global shortage of drugs. So many countries will not be sending drugs to Canada in the long term. So we do need to look at a long-term solution. And my question is simply this. Why does this government always look at voluntary industry response to things? And why is it that this government has to wait until there is a crisis before they take any action at all? Especially in a situation here, we are talking about the life and health of patients. Now, today the pharmacists should have been with us, but they're not here. And the reasons that they're not is that the Canadian Pharmacists Association is going to the United States to talk with the Food and Drug Administration and to look at what the American government is doing to help its patients to have access to the problem and to avert the kind of crises we have in Canada. That's what responsible government does. And we want to know why the government here has not done it. And so we know this is a complex issue. We know that there are multiple problems. We hear from the stakeholders that access to raw materials around the world is in short supply. We hear that many manufacturers of drugs have poor manufacturing practices, yes, contamination and quality control.
So the question we're asking today is, why hasn't the government of Canada moved faster? We have, as my colleague Ms. Fry indicated, the issue of Sandoz Quebec, a major manufacturer of generic drugs in Canada, and this clearly falls within the parameters of having a sound industrial policy in Canada, of making sure that we have a research and development policy that results in a vibrant and sustainable pharmaceutical sector, one that's also responsive. You know, it's up to the government of Canada to make sure that this pharmaceutical sector is regulated, to make sure there's good quality control, to make sure we have good manufacturing practices, to make sure that we maintain a security of supply of these critical drugs in this country. It's not good enough to take the laissez-faire approach of the Conservative government. This is an example, in fact, where the voluntary approach hasn't worked, as in fact the government of Canada was warned months ago and probably a year and a half ago, when we have a letter from the U.S. FDA to Novartis, the parent company of Sandoz Canada, telling them about not only about the problems that they found last year in April, in July, and so forth, but pointing out the fact that these were problems that they had highlighted a year previously in July of 2009. So, you know, why wasn't the government of Canada aware of these? And if it was aware of these problems that the FDA was finding, then why did it give a green light last fall for Sandoz Canada to keep operating? Why hasn't it dealt with this problem? This situation with Sandoz in Quebec is very disturbing, and it highlights a number of failures on the part of this Conservative government. The situation underlies why we need federal leadership in this area, something the Conservatives have failed to provide. As I mentioned, last fall the government gave Sandoz a green light to go on. This was just weeks before the FDA, in fact, flagged major problems at this manufacturer. It's clear from this that we're now dependent on the U.S. to regulate the pharmaceutical sector in Canada. That's pretty scary. Alarm bells, in fact, should have gone off with the government of Canada in July of 2009, but the government failed to act. The question that remains here is, why was the government asleep at the switch? And the provincial governments were notified just 2 weeks ago. Well, why did the government of Canada, why did Health Canada wait until February of this year to notify the provinces? This, of course, prevented them from finding ways to manage this crisis. Had they known sooner, they could have taken actions to deal with the oncoming problem, as they're now trying to do.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Question de la salle, Samantha Bayard.
Now, you mentioned, obviously, that the provincial and federal government could have done a lot in advance to solve the problem. What kind of solutions would you suggest now to try, what kind of decisions do you think need to be made to kind of deal with the crisis?
Well, first and foremost, there's an immediate solution that has to be done. And what the government should do is to set up a pan-Canadian system, and the federal government should do that, which is anticipates, identifies, and manages drug shortages, similar to the one that the FDA has been having now for the last few years to deal with this issue. So that's the immediate solution. But in the long term, there needs to be an investigation, which is going on in the United States, as to what is going to happen globally to drug shortages. What is happening? Why are there drug shortages? What can we do to ensure that Canadian patients have a long-term supply of the prescription drugs that they need to keep them healthy and, in some cases, to keep them alive? Now, we've been calling for this from this government. The Pharmacists Association of Canada has been calling for this for 2 years. We've been calling for it for a year. And all we've been getting is there's a voluntary solution here. So this government has failed to act in the best interests of Canadians. And what I think is most disconcerting is that they're blaming the provinces for sole sourcing these drugs, when it is up to the federal government to ensure there's a vibrant pharmaceutical industry. They are the ones who act as the FDA, Health Canada. They are the ones who look at quality control and who look at supply of drugs. So this federal government continues to shift responsibility to provinces. Now, the provinces are calling for the same things we're calling for in terms of the immediate and long-term solutions. And if we had had these systems in place when we had asked for them, we would have been able to avert this crisis. We could have foreseen the problem and warned the provinces, as you heard Geoff saying, warned the provinces in time for them to find some other drugs. But that is still only a short-term solution, because a global issue is a problem. Countries are not going to give Canada drugs when they need it for their own people if there's a short supply. So we need to deal with the long-term problem.
I think
what Geoff
is
saying is that the FDA has been doing this now. They've been managing this situation. And the point is, that's what responsible government does. And so we are saying that this government has not acted responsibly with regard to this issue. I just wanted to point, I think Geoff told you about epilepsy drugs, for instance. That we know, as a physician I can tell you, that in order to get a patient with a chronic disease like, say, epilepsy or many other chronic diseases to control and to live with a good quality of life with their particular disease, means that you try them on different drugs, and sometimes you find the only one that actually does have the least side effects and is able to control their disease state. The point is, you can't just substitute, and you cannot substitute today. If there's no more drugs, you can't substitute tomorrow, because sometimes those patients will then become very sick while they're adjusting to the new drug, if they adjust to the new drug. So I think what makes us so concerned is, one, the irresponsibility of the government with regard to this issue, and the fact that we're talking here about real patients, real lives, and real problems that could risk their health and, in some instances, their lives. And I think that's why we're trying to flag this.
Now, with regards to the... obviously, the voluntary system doesn't work. What kind of system, with regards to the pharmaceutical companies, do you think would work best? What kind of arrangement between the government and those companies?
Well, I think the federal government has to have, as I say, a pan-Canadian system like the FDA has, where there is, if not a department, but a group that actually anticipates demands, has mandatory reporting, anticipates what drugs are going to be short within, say, 6 months or whatever, or a year, identifies what those drugs are, identifies where they're going to find substitutions and if they can, and manages the shortages. So they must work very closely with the pharmaceutical industry, but it must be on a mandatory basis. I mean, we've seen this government do this in the past. They've always asked for voluntary industry responses. It's happened with the sodium strategy, and it hadn't worked, and yet the government refuses to deal with this problem. We've seen it happen with energy drinks, when the department has told the government to go ahead and that the voluntary system will not work, that this must be a behind-the-counter drug. The government has refused to do it. So the question that we have to ask here, and I know that it's a difficult one because my colleague here is the industry critic, but the point is, if you're talking about a patient's life and health, and you cannot just leave voluntary systems in place for industry. The health minister is responsible for the protection and the health of Canadians, not for the protection and the health of industry. I think one of the things that Geoff was calling for is for regulating quality control, regulating the pharmaceutical industry so that there is quality control, there is not contamination of a drug. That, I mean, one of the things we found out about Sandoz is that the injectable drugs were crystallizing. 5 out of 7 samples were crystallizing in the tube. This is bad quality control. Why isn't this regulation occurring to make sure that happens? There's a second problem. If we have a vibrant research and development sector to look at the fact that if we're having shortages of raw supplies for making certain drugs and manufacturing certain drugs, could we create research and development that will help us to find substitutes, whether they're other kinds of molecular structures if we can't get the raw materials? Should we not be doing this now? And thirdly, we know, and the United States has flagged this, that some companies are no longer making effective and old drugs that are really have been working for patients for a very long time because it's no longer profitable. Now, what do we do about that? This is an issue that we need to ensure that when a company is, and I don't know what Geoff's suggestion is if you have an industry that is supplying something that ensures life and health of people, you can't just allow them willy-nilly to stop doing it. So what are the systems you can put in place to create incentives, to ensure that this continues to be there, that viable supplies and that drug companies don't suddenly stop producing drugs that are vital for people's health and life?